Thank you, Charles, and good morning to you all. Thanks for the devotions this morning, mate. Gel well with what I'm about to do. Well, in our first session together, I explored the account given in John's Gospel of the way that God brings about transformation and renewal. The transformative work of God takes place most especially through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and through the Spirit released through Jesus' ministry. In the second session, I spoke of the ways in which God authorizes and utilizes our various cultures, but also of their fallenness. I spoke also of the need to expose our cultures to the searching light of the Word of God. Although the theme has not been absent in what I've said so far, today I want to focus a little more on the ways in which God involves the church in his transformative work. Excuse me. In his book, Captive to the Word, Miroslav Volf has this to say. To the extent that theology is able to shape broader society at all, it will be able to do so largely to the degree that it is able to shape the life of Christian communities. The church in its own life, Volf suggests, must be a community that bears witness to the transformative and renewing work of God. Only then might it contribute to the transformation and renewal of our wider society and culture. A similar point is made by Leslie Newbegin, whose writings in the latter part of the 20th century constitute a profound analysis of the need for Western culture to be transformed and renewed by the gospel. Newbegin says, the most important contribution which the church can make to a new social order is to be itself a new social order. Now, the view proposed here by Newbegin, by Volf, and by many others who pondered the contribution of the church to the transformation of culture accords, it seems to me, with the kind of advice we read of in the New Testament as well. In his letters to the various churches, Paul, for example, typically urges the church to be itself a distinctive community. We've heard about that this morning. Formed by Christ, and bearing witness in its life together to the saving death and resurrection of Jesus. Douglas Herring suggests that Paul in his letters is concerned with the formation of a people, my quote, which by the shape of its life bears testimony to the world-transforming power of the good news of Jesus Christ. Herring goes on to observe that in Rome, Paul calls for the formation of one people out of two cultures, Jew and Gentile, while in Corinth he calls for the formation of an other people in the midst of a common culture. But in each case, the gospel not only calls forth a people, but also shapes a specifically Christo-formed culture among that people, a culture ordered to Christ. And 3 points of importance here. First is a reiteration of a point made yesterday. The formation of one people does not require that Gentiles become Jews or that Jews become Gentiles. And the same surely applies to all of our cultures. We can be one people while still remaining Samoan and Maori and Australian and New Zealander and so on. Paul's advice to the Galatians that in Christ there is neither Jew nor Greek does not mean that the distinctive features of the two cultural identities are obscured, any more than the distinctive features of male and female are obscured by the parallel insistence that there's neither male nor female in Christ. Rather, Paul seems to be saying that these distinctions are relativized. These points of distinction are no longer to be treated as the defining mark of anyone's identity, nor are they to be the cause of division or discrimination. These distinctions, rather, together with the inequalities, divisions, and tensions that often arise from them, are superseded by the unity that is discovered and experienced in communion with Christ Jesus. That's the first point. The second flows from it. Without abandoning the distinctiveness of our cultures, the unity established in Christ does issue in a new form of life. And as Herring does, we may call this a new culture. It is, he says, a Christo-formed culture. It's made distinctive by its order in Christ. The third point, arising from Herrick's observation, consistent with what we've seen earlier in Wolf and Newbegin, is that the distinctive culture of the people formed in Christ is a witness. It's itself a witness to the saving and reconciling work of God. So in accordance with these observations, my purpose today is to consider the church as a locus of cultural transformation and renewal. I don't propose to do this in a particularly systematic or comprehensive way, but rather, as I did yesterday, by offering a couple of examples. One of them drawn from the engagements between Māori and Pākehā in New Zealand, and the other being an aspect of the church's life emphasised in the accounts of the early church in Acts, and posing a very considerable challenge, I think, to the church in our own day, especially to the church in the West. The first example will also serve to reiterate a theme that I've been emphasising throughout. God enlists and utilises our cultures to bring about his purpose. I noted yesterday the inclusion of Gentiles among the people gathered together in Christ presented itself initially to the church as a considerable challenge. It took time to work through the implications of the cultural diversity and to understand how this rapid expansion of the people of God beyond the people of Israel should be understood to cohere with God's purpose. Peter's vision, recorded in Acts 10, his subsequent encounter with Cornelius, and the further outpouring of the Spirit upon Gentiles, led Peter to recognize that baptism could not be withheld from the Gentiles who had received the Holy Spirit just as we have. Recognizes. It would be Paul in due course who provided the theological reasoning by which the inclusion of Gentiles could be seen in terms of the fulfillment of the promise once given to Abraham that all the families of the earth would be blessed. I want to suggest today that this cultural diversity brought about through the rapid expansion of the gospel to all corners of the world should be seen as a divine blessing, and that in our life as a church together, our being made one in Christ with brothers and sisters who are not like us is itself a witness. There are numerous ways, I think, in which the diversity of the church can be seen as a blessing, but I want to concentrate on just one. It's frequently been my experience that engagement with other cultures is a crucial means by which I come to recognise my own blind spots, the excesses and the deficiencies of my own culture. It's exposure to and fellowship with my brothers and sisters who are not like me, through which I learn of my own need for further transformation and redemption. Paul is absolutely right when he speaks of the members of the body needing one another. We simply can't be the church on our own, either as individuals or as isolated ethnic or cultural groups. One very important fruit of cultural diversity is that the witness of other cultures to the ways and works of God frequently alerts us to things that we might not have seen so readily without the insight of others. And as I've suggested, for me that has come about especially through the engagements of my church with Māori. My grandparents were missionaries amongst Māori, more particularly among the Tūhoe people, whose tribal lands are the densely forested hills of Yeruwera Ranges in the central North Island. Tūhoe's lands once swept down towards the east coast of the North Island at Kapitāne, Ohopi and Opotiki. Or they did until in 1866, 14,000 acres of their coastal lands were confiscated by the New Zealand government as a reprisal for a rebellion among Māori in the region. The rebellious episode, as it was called, was one in which Tūhoe themselves had very little involvement. One of those who was involved from another tribe was thought to have taken refuge in Tūhoe territory. another of the perpetrators had some tenuous connection with Tuvoi. And finally, a letter of protest about the government's handling of the situation sent by surrounding tribes was sent on behalf of the whole region, and so Tuvoi were implicated. On account of these slim associations to the trouble, Tuvoi were included in the punishment meted out to the surrounding tribes. 448,000 acres of land was taken from the tribes of the area. 14,000, as I've mentioned, of those acres belonged to Tuvoi. Now that incident set the scene, unfortunately, for the relations between Tuvoi and the government, with reverberations that continue to the present day. Over time, more land was seized by the government without payment to the Tuvoi people. Land was taken in exchange for the provision of services that never eventuated. In 1893, the Native Land Purchase and Acquisition Act empowered the government to purchase or lease large tracts of Māori land, and in conjunction with an amended 1894 Public Works Act, gave the Crown unfettered rights to build roads, telegraph and railways across Māori land without compensation. Where Māori did receive payment for land, it was at unjust prices. Between 1891 and 1911, for example, when a lot of this land acquisition went on, the price paid to Māori for their land was about 6 shillings an acre. By comparison, an average of 84 shillings an acre was paid for land acquired from Pākehā byways, the Māori term for non-Māori New Zealanders. In many other ways, the relation between Tuvoi and the Crown has been fraught with tensions. Key leaders among Tuvoi, including religious leaders, have been held in suspicion. One in particular, Rua Kenana, was hounded for years by the government and was eventually imprisoned on the basis of a very dubious legal charge against him. The simmering discontent and resentment caused by this and other incidents continues to the present day. Now, I've told the story only briefly here, but there is enough in this telling, I hope, to make clear the need in this situation for repentance, for forgiveness, and for reconciliation. Many white New Zealanders remain resistant to the stories of past injustice and oppression that were repeated up and down the country as British and European settlers asserted their right to inhabit the land that belonged to Māori. There is no easy way to transform hearts and minds to encourage an acknowledgement of past injustice and sin. One of the things that is absolutely vital to the process, however, is that we meet one another, spend time together, listen to one another's stories, meet at table, share bread. And the church, of course, is an ideal place to do just that. In my own church's work among Māori, we have learned things in our encounter with Māori, in fellowship with our Māori brothers and sisters in Christ. We have learned things about what forgiveness entails, about what the hospitality of God looks like, about the operations of grace. Despite the injustices suffered at the hands of colonisers, Māori were generally welcoming of the Christian missionaries and accepted the Christian gospel, not least because, despite harsh criticism from other settlers, and despite making mistakes along the way, missionaries were often at the forefront of efforts to protect Māori from the worst effects of colonial invasion. Māori themselves, meanwhile, quickly saw that the Christian scriptures proclaimed a message of justice, of liberation from oppression, and of equality in Christ. They responded very quickly to the biblical story of the Exodus, and to God's deliverance of his people from bondage and oppression. Time and again, Māori leaders have appealed to the Exodus tradition in their engagements with the colonial government and in their understanding of their own identity. The conversion of Māori to Christian faith creates an imperative for peace and reconciliation between Pākehā and Māori that no Christian can rightly deny. Ephesians 2:14 to 22 provides us a simple statement of this imperative and calls the church to live out the unity and reconciliation that has already been accomplished in Christ. And yet, Pākehā Christians in New Zealand are descendants of the colonisers and have often retained a colonising mind. Our conceptions of entitlement and of property ownership, of how we are related to the natural environment, of how the land ought to be turned to productive use, and so on, are shaped largely by Western culture. Pākehā Christians in New Zealand have not, in general, been any more cognizant of or sympathetic to the just claims of Māori than most other white New Zealanders. And yet, we keep saying we are one body in Christ with our Māori brothers and sisters. It's taken us a long while to learn what that means. And we've been learning it most especially, not by theorising about it, but by the simple act of meeting. Māori are a profoundly hospitable people. Indeed, the honour or the mana of a Māori tribe or iwi depends in large measure upon their extension of hospitality, mana ki tanga, to visitors, to strangers. When visitors approach a marae, a place at the heart of Māori life set apart for the gathering of the community, the visitors are expected to wait at the entrance gates before being called to enter by one of the senior women, the local people. A strictly followed protocol involving speeches and the offering of gifts then provides a means for breaking down the barriers that may divide host from visitor, and for removing any threat one might pose to the other. The process is structured around a movement from darkness, the ko, symbol of conflict and tension, to light, te ao. The ritual of welcome culminates in a hongi, the pressing of noses by which the breath or spirit of life is exchanged, and the people become one. Unity is the goal of this process, and it always concludes with the sharing of food to celebrate and enact the newly established peace and reconciliation. There will always be prayer during the process. The food will not be eaten without giving thanks to God, and further prayer will be offered when host and visitor gather together in the whanau or meeting house to proceed with the business of the visit. And finally, each day closes with further prayer. Pākehā New Zealanders, privileged to share in this process, learn something about hospitality, about forgiveness, about the grace of God. Because there are echoes in this process, I suggest, of God's gracious hospitality shown toward us, enacted whenever Christians gather at the Lord's table to receive bread and wine, forgiveness and new life. This too is a ritual of reconciliation. This too is an extension of hospitality requiring that we make peace with our brothers and sisters. This too opens up a new future that would otherwise have been precluded by our sin. Whatever the wrongs that have been done against Māori, and however just may be their complaint against their oppressors, Māori have never ceased to extend this hospitality whenever Pākehā New Zealanders have ventured onto their marae. There may be, and often is, some straight talking to be done when the business of the meeting is conducted. The hospitality shown does not preclude the truth being told about past injustice and present grievance. But the establishment of peace and reconciliation, the clearing away of enmity and suspicion, are the conditions necessary for honest engagement with the truth. And again, that is the pattern of God's dealings with us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, making peace through the blood of his cross. It's precisely in light of that gracious act of forgiveness and reconciliation that we are enabled to face the truth of our past and present sinfulness and to offer a genuine repentance. The hospitality of God precedes our repentance. It precedes the transformation of our hearts and minds. And in like manner, those Pākehā who have experienced the hospitality of Māori or Ngāmarae are more likely, in consequence, to recognise both the injustices of the past and the need for healing and repentance. Given that the Christian gospel consists in this same pattern of hospitality, reconciliation, truth-telling, and repentance, Christians in New Zealand have both a compelling reason and a particular responsibility to share with Māori in these practices of reconciliation, of peace building, providing therefore the opportunity for the truth to be told about the injustices of the past. That is to say, we have a particular responsibility to be the church, to be that community of sinners who have been brought into reconciled communion with friends, with strangers, and even with enemies. Whenever we are dealing with injustices of the past, the question arises whether the present generation has any role to play in offering forgiveness or repentance for sins long since past. In New Zealand, one often hears the argument that contemporary New Zealanders who did not themselves confiscate land illegally, or who have not themselves had land taken from them, have no responsibility to repent, and nothing to forgive. Such an argument, I think, is inadequate for several reasons. First, it fails to appreciate the extent to which the sins of parents are visited on succeeding generations. People whose ancestors were dispossessed of land in the 19th century remain dispossessed in the present generation. They remain without the resources to grow crops, to build homes, to develop the economic and recreational potential of the land that was once theirs. Likewise, the present generation of white New Zealanders continue to be the beneficiaries of unjust land acquisitions and to enjoy the wealth built up over generations of farming and cultivating what was once Māori land. These are generalisations, of course. There are prosperous Māori and there are underprivileged Pākehā in New Zealand today. But the disproportionate representation of Māori in the adverse measures of social well-being, imprisonment, unemployment, health problems, and so on, is the legacy of past injustice. Now, it's true, of course, that despite efforts to make reparation, there are sins of the past that cannot now be undone. People died in the struggles over land. The Pākehā killed Māori when they stood in the way of the acquisition of land, and at times Māori killed Pākehā in acts of revenge. And so the question, can we forgive or can we repent of these sins suffered and committed by our ancestors? Have we any authority, let alone any responsibility, to forgive or repent of sins that were perpetrated by and against people now dead? Christianly conceived, I think we have learned in our engagements with Māori, that is not the right question. The question is whether we will consent to participate in the forgiveness and the repentance offered already on our behalf by Christ. In coming among us, in submitting himself to our baptism for repentance and the forgiveness of sins, in carrying that baptism through to the cross and resurrection, Jesus takes upon himself the full burden of our human sinfulness, suffers in his own person the worst that we do, and in his faithfulness offers a genuine repentance on our behalf. We of the present or of any generation cannot adequately forgive, nor can we adequately repent. but there is one who forgives and repents for us, who thereby gathers us, both sinners and the sinned against, into the presence of God, prepares for us both a place at his banqueting table. The call to follow Christ is a call to be transformed by this work of reconciliation, to join the company of those brought near to God and to one another by the blood of Christ. This is the reconciliation that is celebrated and enacted in the Lord's Supper, and echoed too in the hospitality offered by Māori on the marae, a hospitality that often includes celebration of the Lord's Supper. These are gestures that set the pattern for a new future, a future that is cognizant of, but no longer held captive by the sins of the past. I spent some time telling of the encounter in the church between Māori and Pākehā. My point is simply this. The coming together of two cultural groups in the context of Christian fellowship has provided opportunity for me and for others in my church to learn much about repentance, about forgiveness, about hospitality, and about grace. And I would say that in these things we are learning together of the reconciliation accomplished in Christ, promised to be brought to fulfilment in the kingdom. It is, to be sure, only a foretaste as yet. But in such instances where the walls of enmity are broken down and a genuine communion is established between people from different cultures, the church is being what it is called to be, and can thus offer testimony to the reconciliation that has been accomplished in Christ. About 3 years ago, I got together with members of my extended family and the descendants of other Presbyterian ministers and teachers who had been missionaries among Tūhoe in the early part of the 20th century. Our purpose in gathering was to return the land once given to the church by Māori to establish a mission station at Maungopohatu. Maungopohatu is the sacred mountain of Tūhoe. It is their spiritual home. So we went to Maungopohatu, where the old mission schoolhouse still stands alongside the partially collapsed mission house in which my grandparents lived. 7 acres of land had been given for the mission compound. And we went on behalf of our church to give the land back. The occasion began with the customary kōwhiri, speeches of welcome that were mentioned. There were speeches on both sides, and then an official handing over of the legal title of the land. One of the speakers from the Māori side said that when the government came, they persecuted us and deprived us of our land. When the church came, they loved us. He saw the return of the land once given to the church as a further gesture of love. And he commented that this should be a sign for the nation as a whole of reconciliation, of justice, and of peace. Interestingly, Tūhoe had invited some other guests that day, including a couple of Māori Anglican clergy. Some light-hearted banter went on amongst the Māori speakers, in which the serious message was nevertheless conveyed, see, this is how you do it. The church is called to be itself, to live out in its own life the reality of reconciliation and forgiveness and grace that has been given us in Christ. In that way, it can serve as salt and light in the world, and help to bring about cultural transformation and renewal. I've related a particular instance in which the transformation and renewal begins with the church itself. Our privileged and God-given opportunity in the church to share together in communion with people of many cultures and many races surely is a part of God's work with us to bring transformation and renewal to our wider cultures. But as the Māori speaker said, echoing the point made by Wolf and Ewbingen at the beginning of my remarks today, the church being itself can be a witness to the wider culture of the transforming and reconciling work of God. I've spoken of my own experience, and I've no doubt that each of you in your own context will have comparable stories to tell. In Australia, of course, there are similar challenges involved in facing injustices of the past and in bringing about reconciliation between Indigenous Australians and those that have arrived quite recently. Camilla Cowley is a Christian and a farmer who has established friendships with Aboriginal people who once lived on the land that her family now farms. She has met frequently with them and listened to their stories. She has learned of the hardship they have suffered through being dispossessed of their land. About 10 years ago, Cowley wrote, "Learning the truth of the past brought with it a feeling of guilt that I had gone so far in my life completely unaware of what had happened in my area and oblivious to the repercussions still being felt today. I was unaware of the hurt still being visited upon the descendants of people whose history was changed forever with the advent of the white explorers. There were so many stories. In listening, my guilt overwhelmed me as I regretted so late in the day not knowing, not caring, and not trying to do something sooner. One of the greatest gifts I have been given by the traditional owners has been their forgiveness of my ignorance and their assurance that all that matters is that I am now trying to walk with them." Cowley's story reveals central features of what it means to be the church. The church is a place for the telling and hearing of truth. It's a place for learning of our need for forgiveness and for learning what forgiveness entails. It's a place for learning what repentance means. It's a place where we may learn to walk a new road in company with those we would not normally have called our friends and who might once have been our enemies. The church, insofar as it helps us to do these things, is itself a place of cultural renewal and a witness to the transformative and renewing work of God. My second example is much briefer. I'm just wondering whether we just take a break here.
You've got plenty of time.
Yeah, can you? You're good. All right. A second and much briefer example of how the church can serve the cause of cultural renewal simply by being the church is very different from the first. Particularly because it is a tale not so much of what has been done, but of an area where the church has some work to do, I think, to figure out what needs to be done in order to be the church. I'm speaking of the church's calling to be the church in the face of an economic order that seems to me to be seriously disordered. A striking feature of the early church immediately following the day of Pentecost is the sharing of a common life. In Acts 2:44, we read, "All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need." This feature of the life of the early church is remarked upon again in Acts 4. "Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need." For people of my cultural group, that is, rich Christians living privileged lives in a first world country, These verses in the Bible and many others like them constitute a profound and very discomforting challenge. There can be no escaping the Bible's repeated insistence that God is concerned with our economic life. Wayne Kirkland, the New Zealand youth worker, former car dealer, and Christian writer, sums up well the Bible's message concerning economics. Kirkland writes, God's intention was to bless his people in order for them to be a blessing to the world. For the Israelites, their land was a central part of this covenant relationship with God. It was a gift to be evenly distributed, providing the means for abundance and wealth. However, when Israel disobeyed God, the prophets sought to challenge them about issues of justice, for the covenant carried with it certain responsibilities, including care for those who might become marginalized, the poor. When Jesus came, he brought a stark choice between worship of God and mammon. Money was not neutral to him, nor was it peripheral to his core message. In the early church, a natural implication of this was that giving and sharing became central to the life of discipleship and Christian community. In respect of our economic life, we stand in deep need, I think, of cultural renewal. The arrangements we currently have, both locally and globally, for distributing the blessings of creation, starkly illustrate the depths of human sinfulness. The global economy, as it is currently configured, does not serve us well. Indeed, it is fair to say, I think, that we are enslaved by it. It has enslaved the rich who succumb on a daily basis to the economy's demand that we acquire and consume more and more. It enslaves the moderately well off by insisting again and again that they do not yet have enough. It enslaves the poor by keeping them in subjection and by not allowing them a sufficient share of the blessings of creation. The global economy has become, I suggest, one of the principalities and powers. Jesus recognized the potential of money to enslave us. He spoke of the dangers of mammon, and it was in that context that he said that we cannot serve two masters. He recognized the differing nature of our enslavement at both ends of the spectrum of wealth. To the rich and law-abiding young man, who inquired how he should attain eternal life, Jesus explained that a further obedience was required of him. Sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor. Jesus knew the enslavement from which that rich man needed to be released. Jesus knew too that the poor needed release from their bondage. The poor feature prominently in his preaching of the kingdom. They are there at the beginning of his ministry in Luke, when taking the words from Isaiah, he promises good news for the poor. And shortly afterward in Luke's gospel, he calls them blessed, for the kingdom of God is for them. They feature again in Jesus' parables, in the parable of the wedding banquet, for instance, when it is the poor who receive the master's invitation with joy and are welcomed into the banquet. As you know, as we've referred to briefly, Jesus takes the theme from the Old Testament, where again and again the prophets remind Israel that their obligation to care for those who have been marginalized and who lack the resources to care for themselves. So the church has work to do here, I suggest. There's a need to do some hard thinking about how we might live together in ways that testify to the sufficiency of God's blessing, and to the striking contrast between that divine sufficiency and our culture's persistent message that we never have enough. We need to find ways of living together in economic terms that release us from our present enslavement. This is not a new problem, of course, nor has the church sat idle in the face of poverty. Christians throughout the history of the church have attempted to take seriously the Bible's teaching about our economic life, and have engaged in charitable work among the poor that has yielded huge benefits worldwide. Christians have been active in politics, helping to bring about structural and political change that's helped to deliver good news to the poor. And yet, despite all these efforts by faithful Christian people down the ages, The global economy asserts its power over us all the more forcefully today. And none of us are exempt from this vast cultural disorder. Both rich and poor are caught up in it. All of our lives are profoundly affected by it. Naming the problem is not biblical. Recognizing in the Bible a persistent call for us to deal differently with the blessings provided for us in creation is not difficult. Finding solutions is difficult. But here again, I think Christians have a place to start, and that place is the church. We need to seek the guidance of God in this together. Expose ourselves and our cultures to the searching light of Scripture. Learn from the communion of saints who have gone before us and from their efforts in various ways through the ages to have all things in common and share the resources they had with any who have need. And there are such things going on in the church. There are Christians who are trying to live more obediently in response to Scripture's teaching about economics. There are individuals quietly resisting the culture's insistence that their lives will not be fulfilled if they do not acquire more possessions. There are people like Sarah Miles at St. Gregory's Church in San Francisco, who has made the church's communion table into a servery from which is distributed not only bread and wine, but boxes and boxes of food every week for those who have need. There are Christian aid agencies throughout the world seeking to ensure that the basic needs of the poor are provided for, though their efforts are a drop in the bucket, as we all know, important though that drop is to many people. There is the movement called the New Monasticism, in which Christians get together, try to live more simply, and try to order their lives according to the divine economy, in which enough is enough, and it is enough for all. There are different things going on in these places and through these agencies. Different things being undertaken by Christians that testify to God's ordering of things and to a different way of being. But there is more to be done, much more, I suggest. Despite these pockets of resistance and difference, the economic life of Christians, in the West at least, is largely indistinguishable from the life of the deeply disordered culture in which we find ourselves. I do not mean to end on a gloomy note, but I think that if we are interested in cultural transformation and renewal, then our economic life is certainly something that needs our attention. The Bible gives us plenty to draw upon. Furthermore, the church has practices from the past, especially in the monastic tradition, that it can learn from and reshape according to the needs and challenges of our own time. But especially, of course, the church lives under the lordship of Christ and in bold hope of the coming of the kingdom in which the last shall be first and the first last, and God's blessing of creation will be fulfilled. So I do not raise the problem of our economic enslavement in order to engender despair among us, but rather to encourage our further thinking about the cultural changes that are needed here. We need to consider what obedience might mean in this context for those who claim to follow Christ. One of the things we discovered together is that one of the things that prevents us from the kind of reckless generosity the gospel encourages us towards is this fear that we might leave ourselves short. And it's only in being generous that we discover those fears to be unfounded. Yes.
Murray, I read an article a short while ago with forgiveness in foreign policy.
Yeah.
And I use it in ethics class, and it's universally met on first reading with incredulity. But then I encourage them, let's just sit and think about what's being said. I think Catherine Tanner and some of her work are similar sorts of things. It's too big a question again, but how does a church, so in my context, where with Maori, for instance, there's no close association with Maori in terms of Browns Bay, very rich, very white. I wouldn't know where the nearest marae would be.
Yeah.
I don't even know if there is one on the North Shore. Well, I mean, AUT has one, but... So what does this say to communities where there is a dominant culture, almost 99% saturation of a monoculture, who hear this stuff, sit with it, and do feel compelled? We must do something.
The challenges present themselves in different ways, in different contexts, as you were suggesting. I think even bringing about a change in attitude is something that churches can help with, because I hear a lot of white people slagging off Maori and saying that they're all grudges and nothing to make amends for in the past and so on. And that's born of ignorance, one thing, but it's also born of the fact that they've never met Maori in the kind of context that I've been talking about. And facilitating the fellowship is just so thoroughly Christian a principle. It's by that means that reconciliation is brought about. So I think the churches are well placed here, actually, because in Presbyterian, Methodist, Anglican, Baptist, whatever it might be, there's going to be Maori congregations somewhere. And so we have a bit of a head start in this. We are already brothers and sisters of Christ. So we need to try and be creative and think about ways we can actually help that to be realised in a much more meaningful way.
So start with, are you saying, start with what's easiest, those Christian communities?
Yeah.
And then go from
there. Yeah, I think so.
So an observation, it seems to me that the missing element, I can't speak about New Zealand, but it's the relational dimension that seems to be the missing element. Even within the church community, not necessarily even cross-culturally or whatever, but it's outside of it. And developing that depth of relationship within a community is a very, very difficult task. And perhaps that relates to individualism in the West as well as other factors. But I just think of my own recent experience with a former Aboriginal student. It was in the opportunity to sit together and to listen for an hour and a half that barrier or that dysfunction in relationship was resolved. And why we didn't do it earlier, we might kick ourselves, of course. But it just strikes me that this relational dimension is so surface and shallow in our churches, and perhaps everywhere in the Western community.
Yeah, there's all sorts of factors that contribute to it, of course. But the homogeneity of our churches, generally, I think, is a serious problem. And it militates against the kind of reconciliation we're actually called to act in.
I think one of the things that is real simple for Christians to get a hold of is the idea of honour and dignity. And it's hard to argue against the responsibility of the church to share dignity with those who have had it deprived from them. And to the Christian community shown in Australia was very often the Christians that most struggle with our former Prime Minister's desire to offer an apology to the Aboriginal people. But one of the most significant things that I saw occur in those moments of apology was the restoration of dignity to the Aboriginal people. The tears in their eyes just because someone took the bold step to do it. And our position as the church ought to be, if it's as simple as that, to restore dignity, it wouldn't apologise a thousand times, And those sort of things are just so very, very simple. And so you can spend all this time debating and arguing rational positions of past and whatever, but you see a person deprived of dignity, it ought to be the Christian cry to restore that dignity.
And we Christians should know the truth sets us free. Apology is about truth telling.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's the thing that we're afraid of.
Yeah.
Admitting the truth.
Sorry, I'm just wondering, I just want to come from another angle. I think what all the ways of meeting people. And yeah, I certainly see that. I guess it's kind of how do we not demonise? You know, we're saying God's at work through all cultures, and I agree there's huge issues in terms of global economy and those kind of things. How do we, I mean, this morning we heard, why not be offended for the sake of your brother? And, you know, if we're talking about a particular situation where someone's carrying offence from years and years and years, and I understand my cultural heritage in saying this, I'm just trying to throw it out to the discussion. And we're coming together to speak the truth, and that's, you know, a truth in our scriptures to say, well, yeah, we know you are offended, but also, well, is there not a place where, as a church, we allow that offence to be carried? Or so, I mean, that's a very specific issue. That, but I just think there's a sense of where the gospel works in all, you know, it challenges all cultures and challenges both cultures. And so I guess the underlying question maybe, what is some of the things that we take into that environment and actually are saying, well, what are the benefits of the culture that has been established in the West? Because it's not all that. It does have heritage to a Christian, you know, sort of worldview. And so, yeah, and how do we balance between each? We see it's become destructive in a lot of ways as well, but that's got to be where it's moving away from what it's been established on as well.
Yeah, thanks, Dad. There are a lot of difficult questions that Dr. Clutching your way through. I guess the one I suppose I'm trying to make here is that we're unlikely to figure those out unless we enter into a genuine fellowship across culture in our churches. And we are ideally placed to do it because the church. We have a head start over against the rest of our culture in already being made one in Christ. And so we can figure out how to actually live that out. And in the living of it, we'll start to figure out answers to those kinds of problems and challenges.
Yeah.
Okay.
Trying to get out of it.
Right, yeah.